Morning, friends. Really nice to be here and to see very, very animated faces and very, very keen, especially young people who are very keen to engage with issues and to understand what is happening and what is it we can do, because many of us can fall into fixed patterns and also get very cynical about things. So I think it's nice to know that there's never a day when there's nothing new to talk about and to really engage with, because I think talking we all do a lot, but we need to really engage with and act. I think what is interesting at this juncture for us to be meeting is that the last few years have given us a lot of churning in the field of education. There have been some new policies which have come in. There has been reaffirmation and rearticulation of some of our older policies. But what is happening more is that there is a time, I mean, I draw your attention, say, to the latest Supreme Court verdict. Because right now what's happening is that the Supreme Court has to step into many things. And the Supreme Court has to remind us that, yes, the right to education is crucial, because it actually, that is the focus of social, the social fabric of democracy, a classroom or a school. And I think that is important. I think we've become too used to these statements. We sort of take it in our stride, and everyone calls us the nation builders and, you know, all kinds of things, and we're very happy, pat ourselves and move ahead. But I don't think we are thinking seriously about it. And I think that is what I really want to do with you. Why is it that the court keeps reminding us about the social fabric of democracy? What does this mean? Why does it say that, yes, the right to education is ratified for that? We really need a lot of mixing of populations, mixing of children from different backgrounds, us as teachers understanding what that means, and giving a forum which is democratic. What does that mean? And does it shake us up to say that this is a challenge for us? Because I can say, working in education, that I find this much more difficult today than I did 20 years back. I find society, and I find schools, and I find any forum, the public park, I find all these spaces so totally segregated and so stratified that the challenge of talking of democracy for me today is much more daunting than it was even 20 years back. We hear the word inclusion, we hear, you know, all these words, and the struggle to get a right to education, why after 60 years of independence? We had it in our constitution. Why is it that we needed an act right now? So I think we really need to shake up. And I really think that we need to take a lot of the smiles and hope and the criticality of our younger colleagues than the complacence and the sort of, you know, that we might bring. We might, the cynicism that we might bring, that we've seen it all. Oh yes, of course we know it all. This was talked of in the Kothari Commission. This was talked of in the University Education Commission. 48, we've taught all these policies. I think we need to really get ourselves out of that, because even today, when we read the University Education Report, the first education report of an independent country, it gives us a vision of a university which we just don't see, and we're not even thinking of. We are talking about universities, the need for more universities. We are talking about, you know, all these bills that are hanging in Parliament. But we are not even, what was this vision that was being thought of in terms of a university? It was not me for my job. That was not the vision of higher education. That was not the vision of any education. Why is it that we are accepting that today? Have we changed our vision for education? I mean, in fact, all those were talking about building a country, trying to understand how large populations of our country are living in disadvantage, how will it address their health, how will it address other issues of life and death, and will a university really harness a lot of knowledge and practice and wisdom from the field to address this and to change the country? Every time we read those documents, it shakes us, because this is not what we even hear in any public discourse or even a private discourse today. So what has happened? Have we changed our view of education? If we have, where? Why? And where have we documented that change? So I think it really does, you know, shake us and ask us to look differently. What was the NCF 2005? It's entered our courses. We ask a question, maybe in your latest B.Ed. exam, there may be a question on the NCF 2005. We do it, you know, the questions asked, answers given, marked, happy. Do we see a change? Do we even see ourselves engaging with it and trying to say, what is it saying? What is it saying about the questions that we are asking today, that half our children are pushed out of school? Yes, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan may have made a change in terms of enrollments, but what has it done? It's really stratified our system much more. You use the word government school and immediately certain images come. Why doesn't a Kendriya Vidyalaya come to our mind? Even that's a government school. It's functioning with an ethos which is much more sort of inclusive. My own PhD students have done researches recently and we have seen how the children studying in a government school, in a Kendriya Vidyalaya, or how a teacher, what perceptions they have about a learner or about the process of learning, and how any learner can be learning. Whereas an elite school, a child of class 7 is saying, and saying it with absolute no qualms, is saying that, why does the government waste money on government schools? These children are like animals. They break up everything. Why should the government spend money on that? A class 7 child is saying it. Where is this discourse coming from? A teacher in that school is teaching and saying, she's talking about history and she's talking about 2 centuries earlier about the royal family, and she's saying, you know, just like we make friends only amongst people of our background, this is how the kings made friends. So what is happening? I mean, is this discourse being addressed? And so the Supreme Court has to address, I mean, the whole media goes berserk because 25% of children from economically weaker sections becomes the big issue. There are many other big issues in the Right to Education Act. And have we educationally understood those issues? We seem to be so agitated that we cannot fail a child, that we cannot detain a child. You must be seeing that agitation. Teachers are saying, ab kya padhaye, fail to kar nahi sakte, to kyun padhaye? I mean, isn't this amazing for a person working in education? Why is our ethos of education so tied up with the notion of selection, filtering people? There are only some who can be passed, the others have to be failed. If you are failed, you will become a better learner. Where have these folk sort of mythologies, folk pedagogies come in from? Where have they come in from? There are countries which have moved beyond this, where the word detention is a punitive connotation, is not used in education, because education is not about detention. And where they say that if you really want to support a child, you don't detain a child, put a stamp failure, and then you'll make a person more motivated to learn, going through the same rigmarole for another year. So if this is basic common sense, why is this not there in our nerves and our systems of understanding, in our folk pedagogies? Why? Why is it that anyone, when we talk about not having a selective board exam or a class 12 exam, the middle class is up in arms? You're making wimps of our children. They will not learn competition. They will become useless. What is this? So don't you think that our job as teacher educators has become even more challenging? If we understand why an act has to say this, an act is a serious issue. It's a legal mandate. If an act has to remind us what we have not really remembered, and that act is not coming from the air, it's coming from sound educational practice and principles. Because all over the world, there are, you know, countries today which are called countries which are good quality education countries. Just think in your minds. What countries come to your mind when you think of a country which is really giving good quality education?
Yeah.
Finland comes to the mind, because we have read a lot about Finland. But what about Finland? What is crucial about Finland? What about how does Finland prepare its teachers? Can we understand of the day when the biggest career that is really dreamt of by the best of our students is not being an engineer, not being a doctor, but a teacher? That is true in Finland. Their students really aspire to be teachers. How have they done that? What has teacher education meant to them? And what has education meant to them? And their curriculum, their entire changing of curriculum took 20 years, 15 to 20 years of very, very serious total restructuring. Because even they, like many others earlier, believed that children, it's a good model if you can test children early and then, you know, give different children different inputs. You know, like even we believe, the gifted can be given something and the backward can be given something. And I'm using these words with inverted commas because till very recently, my own university, my own department, in an MEd runs a program called the gifted and the backward children. Because we believe in this. We carry these baggages and these connotations of there are some who are gifted, there are some who are backward. Test them early. Singapore does it even today. Test them after class 4. Those who are really doing badly, don't burden them with academics. Give them a more diluted kind of a curriculum. And put them in a separate track. And in Singapore, and this debate is really live in Singapore, which does very well in international assessments. So they are critiquing their own policies. I was part of a whole deliberation there. I was part of a team which was going into schools, closely observing, videotaping, closely what is happening in classrooms, because we often don't do that. A lot of our assessments or programs don't really go into the classroom. That's still a black box. You know, and we don't want someone coming into our classroom and we get very agitated or the teacher will get agitated. But they were closely, on a regular basis, assessing what was happening. And even though their classrooms, and when I bring pictures of their schools and I show it to my BEd students, their eyes are gaping. They literally are gaping at those because the government schools of even the poorest localities are, you know, to look at much better than any of our elite private schools. And if you go into a classroom and you just take a snapshot, just arbitrarily take a snapshot, it doesn't look like any of our classrooms in terms of what is happening. Our classroom's architecture is most often like this. There is one person speaking and the others are supposed to be listening. And this is a model we adopt for adults, but we adopt it even in class 1 and class 2 and much more regimented. At least I will not be getting strict with you and not hitting you if I see you fidgeting, and I won't be saying fingers on your lips. But this is what we train our teachers to be doing. They're policing more than teaching. And their classrooms don't look like that. So why is it that the way we understand, but they have started asking questions because after class 4, when they took a test and they found that let's try and see what are we doing? Why are we tracking them differently? And I went to some of the poorest schools where children were in this track. Now, teachers there were trying to motivate them a lot, doing things more through activities, which actually should be for every child. If you're doing things through activities and you're doing things through a lot of oral presentations, that should be for every child. Why should you separate that this child needs this pedagogy and this child needs this pedagogy? But the child was not motivated. Because the child had this unsaid sword hanging on her head or his head that you can never enter university. That track can only go to a polytechnic. Is that democratic? At class 4 you tell a child you can never go to university, even if the child never does, but you're telling the child you're no good. This is what we used to do with our vocational, we still do with our vocational education programs. They are never challenging. They are never creative. They are never sort of self-esteem enhancing. You know, I might be such a good dancer, I might be such a good musician, I might be so good with my hands and so creative, but if I'm doing a course and I'm put in a vocational education course, I never get that feeling that I am special. And this word special has been used in the most derogatory manner in our system. We say it in the most patronizing manner, children with special needs. You know, when we want to tell those children that you are different, you are disadvantaged, you have to be taken, we call them children with special needs. So what is it in our system that is tying us down to this notion, to accepting that selection is a normal thing? We go to a school and our child can be interviewed. Our profile can be seen to see whether the mother speaks English or not, or the salary of the father. I mean, these things have become normal and we accept it. And we need an act to tell us that this is undemocratic, that this will be banned, that you cannot do selection. Why? And if we talk about Finland, or if we talk about Canada, or if we talk about Korea or Japan, where quality has been continuously tied to the notion of equity as teachers understand it. Quality has been tied with the notion of having expectations from every child, not labeling children, these are slow children. Kendriya Vidyalaya was telling us that when we were working on the NCF, that, you know, on the first of every month, we had to make a list and produce and tell them who are the slow learners. So the teacher has to do that. Anywhere we go in our system, when we ask teachers, they say it as if it's very patronizing. Actually, to do good to the child, we want to show that these are the slow learners, then we'll pay special attention to them. And we all know what special attention is paid to them. Can you imagine a child, a young child sitting who comes often from a socially disadvantaged background, does not have the kind of support that is needed to let her come into school? What happens to her when she knows through the eyes of someone? You don't have to give her a certificate. She knows through the eyes of the teacher that I am a slow learner. What happens to her learning? Because all theories today of learning are telling us that it is not notions of competency which we have hung on to for very long, but it's notions of motivation. And it's notions of persistence. And what allows a child to persist at something, how it allows a child to be motivated, continuously to be motivated, not these notions of competency. Even Sternberg, who first wrote of competencies, changed his own theories and his own views. And all research is pointing out to mindsets, as you must have heard, of Carol Dweck's mindsets. That it's a mindset which we're giving a child. And we can change the mindset. If the child knows that there's nothing innate in me about called intelligence, or nothing innate in me which is ability. It's like a muscle. The more I use it, the more it develops. But we, even our teachers, don't believe in this. And we have to accept and see why. And that's why even a snapshot of our classrooms don't look what really all our policies and theories want us to at least move in terms of what is a learning space. How does learning really happen? To not look at teaching. I mean, it's really amazing that we still talk of teaching as a skill, as a reductionist formula of some skills put together. I mean, isn't that amazing? That we can talk of a skill and say, okay, now I'm teaching you this skill and for 5 days you can practice this skill and then for another 5 days you can practice another skill. To here we are fighting this polarization between hierarchies of knowledge and skill. We are saying we don't need a separate national knowledge commission and a separate skill development commission. The NCF is saying that. NCF 2005 has told us that there are not some people who have skills and who are considered less able, and there's some who have knowledge. It's a total redefinition of what knowledge is. Even a weaver is not weaving this fantastic fabric because of the skill that the weaver has. So I think that what we have done is through the hierarchies that we have built into our education system. And people who have read and studied sociologies of education say that yes, in countries, especially in resource-starved countries, what happens is, yes, that education becomes a tool for trying to reproduce these inequalities, and then trying to benefit only from the fact that we have this certification in our hands. But I think that we really have, and whereas our own, if we look at our own 1938 Zakir Hussain Committee report, which probably we teach as a part of our some paper on policy, basic education has become a name that we just talk about as a legacy, as a historical thing. What was it telling us? Why was it insisting of education through life, for life? What did it mean? Why was it saying don't separate this vocational and don't separate this so-called classroom knowledge? And today what we are doing is there is no knowledge construction in the classroom, absolutely no knowledge. It's just purely transmission. Purely just transmission of some information, which the teacher also thinks that we have, the teacher educator thinks she has, transmit to the teacher thinks she can divide some skills, practice some separately, put them together as if skills can really be divided. Even cooking is actually a technology. Cooking is an art. But can you separate skills first and then say that a person will learn cooking? How are we so complacent that we think we can do it with teaching? And I think we really need a lot of shaking up, because we think that, so whenever a new document comes, we read it through the same lens. We read everything and say, ha ha ha, hum jante, hum samajte. But it doesn't necessarily shake us or shake our classrooms. And I think that is my plea, that if we are as a body, as a community of practitioners and theoreticians who really are concerned about education, who really are concerned about this social fabric of democracy and the role that education plays, who really listen to children today in a park, as part of a research, we were talking to a child, and this child from a government school, and today our government schools are so stratified that in Delhi, it's amazing. There can be a Kendra Vidyalay, there can be a Navodaya Vidyalay, there can be a Pratibha Vikas Vidyalay, a word which is really shocking, that you can select Pratibha after a test in class 6 and then do Vikas only of that child. So there is a Pratibha Vikas Vidyalay, there is a this. There are, you know, there's a whole stratification. There's a layer of different kinds of government schools, and the poorest child is going to this poorest school. And that's why everyone thinks that, you know, why talk about government schools? I don't want to put my child in there. I want English medium. I want this. So we're really jumping onto the bandwagon without understanding where is that process, that first process of making sense, of making meaning. The NCF tells us that there can be a tribal child, and you all might have experience. I don't know, very often now, more and more of us urbanites have very little experience of lived social realities of children from different backgrounds. When we were making the curriculum, this happened. There were many teachers and textbook writers who said, we have really actually never lived in a village. So what we are writing is only our perception. And I don't know if that is true in teachers in Mumbai also. But that again is a question mark, because are we preparing teachers only for some 10% of so-called well-resourced schools, or are we preparing teachers for our system? And I think every teacher really should understand our system. And that is the challenge, that if we, so when the NCF is telling us that if there is an Adivasi child, what is her knowledge? What does she know of? How does she know this environment? What does she understand of the soil? What does she understand of all these trees and plants? I wouldn't probably recognize many plants if I were to walk through the forest, but she recognizes, she knows, she can identify, she knows when to use what. But when she comes into the classroom, she's made to feel a slow learner. And the child who has to open a textbook and say, okay, what is this leaf? Okay, does an ant have 6 legs or 8 legs? She has to look at a picture to tell that, because she's never really looked at an ant. So this child, we say, is our so-called bright child who we have to select, the fast learner. What have we done? Why have we reached this point? And if that is being forced on us, to really relook at knowledge construction, at how children are bringing a lot of knowledge. The first question we ask ourselves is that when children come to school, are we as teachers even enabled to understand what knowledge they have? Because when we sit with the SCRT and we ask them that, you know, children are coming late, maybe they're coming at age 8 or they're coming 9, and the RTE has asked us now to be able to give some special kinds of courses, the SCRT's first sort of response was, we'll take a test. We'll take a test and see where they fall. Now, taking a test, taking a paper and pencil test, will it tell us what these children know? I mean, our own students who are now teaching in government schools and teaching in private schools, the government school teachers are saying, why is it that you don't take a test? You call all children, age 6, to some point in the city, you just leave them there, see who reaches home. And the government school teachers say, all our children will reach home. But you'll find the other children standing with their mobile phones, crying, waiting for someone. And why don't you give our children some recognition that they all know how to reach home? So what is it that we are testing? And this becomes much more. So we are doing this test, we are asking them to do something in writing, we force them and say, oh, they cannot write. Can we assess as teacher educators, can we get our teachers to assess and understand and appreciate what knowledges children have when they come into schools to us? Genuinely, not patronizingly, because we can try patronizingly. Ek gana suna do, acha tum kya jante ho, acha tumne kaun si film dekhi hai, you know, pani kahan se aata hai, etc., etc. We can do that, but not genuinely, not critically. Why? So I think I'm just sort of trying to say the kinds of dilemmas which are there, because this is what, when we aspire to be looking at countries, and you said Finland, we can look at countries which are, and a lot of studies in the last 10 years have happened to see what is quality education and how is it that countries are giving all their children that kind of education. And it's not as if Finland doesn't give support to children. We call it remedial teaching. Again, a word which is a pointer to there is an illness in you and we are giving you a remedy. And to a so-called fast learner, we are giving enrichment. So there's remedial for someone and enrichment for someone. Why is there not enrichment for everyone? In the same country, Finland, more than 50% children go through support programs, more than half, right through their elementary years. And in different things, I'm not labeled slow because I might have support for reading, someone might have support for something else, someone might. So when the whole batch, the whole cohort is going through support programs, there's nothing labeled against getting support. Why don't we think of learning in that way? Why don't our teachers think of learning and supporting in that way? We never have group work in a class, never. Whereas our theories tell us that children don't learn alone. They don't learn as individuals. All our social constructivist theories telling us that children are really learning together when they work with each other, mixed abilities, mixed kinds of questions. But we never find this in the architecture of our classroom. We never find that in our own BEd programs. Maybe only as one shot formality might have some group collaborative learning, but that's not how learning happens. Why? And I think these are questions that we seriously need to engage with. We were involved with the NCF. I was involved with the primary level textbooks. And when we go into our own BEd program, where our own teachers are doing their school internship, we often find that they're not using the textbook at all. Why? Because some of our colleagues or someone has told them that as a teacher trainee, you should never be using a textbook because that shows that you don't have confidence. So the textbook lies closed in the bag, the notebook lies closed, the children are just listening and maybe giving a question. The teacher asks the question, children never ask anything. And so what is it? There's a total disconnect between what we might be doing in terms of improving curricula, in terms of improving textbooks, made in a very, very interactive manner to engage children, but the teacher never sort of uses, even if the textbook is not engaging, the teacher has to critically struggle with the textbook and let the children struggle with it. Even if it's an English medium textbook and children cannot really make sense of it, but the meaning making has to be done together, has to be struggled. Why do you leave it to the home or the tutor or whoever it is? So using a textbook as a tool, as one of the resources, negotiating the textbook, not delivering it. Why is it that we don't do it as part of our own BEd programs? Critical use, critical negotiation. I find science classrooms with absolutely no experiments done. At most, maybe a demonstration done. What do we teach about the aims of teaching science? What do we teach about what does really science learning mean? And what happens in a classroom? It's very easy to say, I know, I can also say, oh, there is no equipment, there is no this, there is no that. But in the 70s, right through the 80s and the 90s, even a village school, I can talk of Hoshangabad Science Teaching Project because that's where I have really worked with teachers in the most sort of low-resourced schools. And I have found amazing science being taught and learned and done and constructed together. So why is it that their teacher, I've seen 80 children. I'm not at all endorsing that we can have a class of 80 children. That's again where the RTE comes in to struggle. That's mandated that you can't have more than 35 children. But even when teachers had 70, 80 children, it was not as if they were not doing experiments. It was not as if every child was doing an experiment in groups. And the children were doing responsibly. They will pick up the kit, they will leave it there, they will do it, they'll sit out in the ground, they might sit out in the open and do it because there's no room, but that was how they were learning. And one could see the difference, what it meant to them. When there's a big superstition which happened and truckloads of vegetables are being thrown in the Narmada and in the parliament people were asking questions that, you know, there's a big superstition that leaves have got these white snake-like figures and it's the saap devta ka shrap hai, so sabzi nahi khana hai, green leaves nahi khani hai. That happened and we found, I travelled in that area, I found colleges of education, I mean science colleges, students saying that we don't know what this is and we can't do experiments, koi apparatus nahi hai. But these children on their own, the teachers didn't know what it was. The children on their own were doing experiment, trying, one child found out with a needle, she picked up something she saw in this small 60 rupee microscope which was there in every school, in every classroom. They saw, ye toh keeda hai. And they asked us and the teacher asked us, the children are saying, ye keeda hai. Look at the other way around, the children are asking. Teachers don't know. We also might not know if we are not biologists, ke ye kya hai. But children are saying, ke, and this child says, main toh ghar-ghar gai. Main poore gali mein gai aur sabko kaha ki tum upvaas mat rakho, ye toh keeda hai. On her own, the child is doing. Now, all I'm saying is that, are we providing opportunities for children to do things on their own, think on their own, look for knowledge, not depend that, you know, this is what's in the textbook or this is, and this can happen. It happens every day. We're just not looking at it because we are not attuned to look at learning in that way. So if learning really has not to be just one demonstration shown over here, which 50 children can't even see, but we've done it, or one chart hung over there, and we think teaching aid ho gaya khatam. I mean, if this is not teaching, then where do we go? Do we know where we can go? And do we know how, what does school in practice or school internship mean? What does it mean? I know there is a struggle. I know that In many of your colleges, you have to take three different schools because one school doesn't allow us enough time for the students to be there for their internship. That is a struggle. I know in Delhi, we do manage. We manage a school for 3 months, right through. In our BLED program, we manage schools for 4 months, right through, same class, same children, 4 days a week. It is a struggle, but we think it's important because we don't think we can send students somewhere to one school, next day to another school, third day to another school, say, ho gaya, 20 lessons, ho gaya, khatam, finished, certificate, ho gaya. So if we really need to, and I know it's a struggle, it's becoming even more difficult. I mean, for many years, we didn't have Kendra Vidyalayas. When I was the dean, right now I'm not the dean, it's by rotation, but again, I had to go right through the Kendra Vidyalaya Sangathan, talk to them, engage with them, have 11 schools for our own internship, which are Kendra Vidyalaya, so that it doesn't happen that we only have the very poorly resourced government schools where 100 children are sitting and, you know, the whole impression is as if things just can't work. Yes, it's a struggle, but I also know that we are becoming, it's only our self-interest. We are not going to schools with a genuine sense of responsibility or partnership. We are not concerned about those children as soon as we leave the school, we get come out. We'll go only next year at the time of internship. We are not concerned, wo seekh rahe, nahi seekh rahe, drop out kar rahe, push out ho rahe. We are not concerned. They are not our children. So how can internship be a solid engagement between the school and the university, between the college and between the school? How can they also feel that they are in partnership with us, we the great theoreticians, the great practitioners of education, that we are with them when CCE becomes a challenge and everyone is sort of, you know, wondering what to do, and yes, even CBSE is wondering, even they don't know what to do, then where do we as practitioners work? Not that we might know what to do, but can we work with them, with the same children? Do we feel in partnership? Do we feel responsible? Do we ever feel the need to go to those homes, to the children? Where are they coming from? We never feel the need to go as teacher educators. Our teachers never feel the need to go. Our teachers never think that there's any importance to know where the child is coming from. Pooch liya, tumhare papa kya karte hai, tumhari mami kya karte hai, finished. Why should I be having an engagement with the home or an engagement with the community? We talk about it in our theory papers. We never do it. So can we think of this? Because unless we do, there's no meaning. I mean, how are we talking in our policy documents about crucial, active, organic links between the school, the university, the institute of teacher education, the community, but this is not happening. And it, as soon as people actually go and understand the learner, actually see where they're coming from, see what the aspirations are, see what the child is, you know, what the child's sort of knowledge system is, the teacher becomes sensitive. The teacher can understand learning better because the NCF is telling us that learning is rooted in the learner's worldview, in the learner's culture, in the learner's home. Whereas we often have a very moralistic stand. Even our science teaching teaches the poor child hygiene. Safai se raho, gande rehte ho, pani ubal ke piyo. Isn't it? We are always sermonizing, even through science. There's no sort of scientific critical understanding. We're sermonizing. Wherever we get a chance, we're sermonizing. So there's a moralizing agenda which our students take with them when they go there. How is it going to connect? How is it going to be inclusive? How is it going to give self-esteem? So it is a challenge. And we know that we find this strong disconnect between us and the school. Our own students are not invited. They are very happy to, when they leave school and say, khatam hua. Or when our students want to do something, that school tells them, ye kya tamashe baazi, ye khatam karo, ho gaya bahut demonstration. Come on, come to the point. Do revision of the chapter. There's an exam tomorrow. So there's such a strong disconnect between the learner and the school, between the school and us, teacher educators, between us and the policies. How are we going to bridge this gap? And where do we really, and as I said, in the last 10-20 years, the school has become an extremely divisive place. The Supreme Court told us that a midday meal is important, not just for nutrition, because children can't come and learn on an empty stomach, but to give a space where they eat together. Because in public, they don't have spaces where they eat together. I was telling you of a child in a park, in a Delhi park. She told us that she just happened to speak in the park to another child where her mother works as a domestic help in that rich child's house. She just spoke to that child. The next day, her mother lost her job. And this is happening routinely, especially in metro cities, in large cities, that there is this clear segregation and, you know, people, affluent homes don't want their children to be even engaging with a poor child. So if school and the midday meal where children eat despite their caste, there was resistance in Rajasthan, but you know that in Rajasthan, when you see the studies of the Right to Food campaign, the biggest sort of difference was made there. In Karnataka, in other places where people resisted because a Dalit cook was employed, the government insisted on employing a Dalit cook. And people did come around that. Now, I'm saying it's the court is telling us now what really was also our job in terms of education. And if are we going to use this space to really make education inclusive for all, because all these countries which we talk about, it's not just 5% of their children who do superbly well. It's all their children. And if we go into the details of what they did to their system, they did a lot to shake their teacher education system. Tremendous effort was put into the teacher education effort system. A lot of collective engagement. Teachers, even in-service teachers, continuously are meeting collectively to engage with issues because a teacher can't be left alone. And we know that in so-called good resource schools, this does happen. Teachers engage, they sit together, they talk about curriculum, but then they're doing it again to a very homogeneous kind of a group of children. They don't necessarily understand diversities. And I think that is the challenge. That is what countries, Canada, why is it coming up? Because even immigrant children, large populations of immigrant children, learn as well as any child, because that is the responsibility of the teacher. Not by assimilating, but by understanding the cultural context. So I think if we look now at some of the policy sort of directions which are telling us to look differently. And one of those things, as I said, is that the time that we spend in the school is very limited, is very fragmented, and it's very, very instrumental. We need to do our little job, somehow we manage to do it. And even when we don't go into the classroom, we are telling them, you practice this skill, you practice this skill, which has no learner in front of them, means nothing. So where do we actually engage with the child, with the community, with the home, with the field, understand what is the directorate of education, understand the field office, understand all these things by engaging with it, not just writing a two-page report. So the NCF TE, which actually is, and you all may have read it, but I don't know what kinds of discussions you may have had, is telling us, one, that, you know, there are broad areas of our teacher education program. And it's telling us that in these three broad areas, if we look at school internship as one area, we're not looking at the details right now. We're just saying that if these are the three broad areas of our teacher education program, and it's saying that curriculum and pedagogy is one broad area, and what it's calling foundations of education, we can call them anything, but let's see what we are trying to look at. I think what's important is that till now, if I say paper one to you, you'd all say philosophy of education. If I say paper two, you'd all say psychology of education. Because that's the way we look at our program. You know, we all know that there's a philosophy, or philosophy and sociology, there's a psychology, and there's modern Indian education, or history of education, or policy, or something like that. But education as a field, education as a discipline, we have never felt the confidence of really developing this as a discipline. What does it mean? We still sort of look at it as something. Some philosophy has to come in, some psychology has to come in, and that psychology might tell us some theories of learning, but the student goes into school much before those theories of learning may be done, at least in my department that happens. They might come back from school and then do what is Vygotsky's theory or something like that. So there's total disconnect. And they might rattle off all those theories of learning, but in a classroom, they just don't understand what really it means, what is learning about. They still think teaching is, I have to speak very clearly, I have to speak very well, which is important, or I have to write, my handwriting has to be very good, or I must move around a bit, or I must once in a while ask some questions. Because teaching is all about me. And even when a supervisor comes, the supervisor only giving comments to me, how I performed. There can be 40 machines there, or there can be 40 anybody or 80 anybody there. It's not an interaction. And it's not learner who's at the center of the teaching learning process, which the NCF 2005 is telling us. We call it learner-centered teaching, but please tell me, how many classrooms in your lives have you seen which are really learner-centered teaching? And not learners which are 4 or 5 who stand up every time and raise their hands. So what is it about the teacher who has to forget herself for some time and really understand that teaching and learning is not about me doing all the performance, but is really understanding how learners are learning, where they're coming from. So it's telling us not to talk of this psychology of learning, not to talk of philosophy, but to develop this discipline of education in which you have areas like learner studies, you have areas like curriculum studies, and you know, we know that many of these areas are developed elsewhere. We have not engaged much with it in our own context. We're not saying we'll take one theory from somewhere and one theory from Finland and one theory from America, but in our own context, how do we understand these things? Of course, theoretically, there is a base to much of this. So there is an area called contemporary studies, which is saying that do we understand our own country, our own region? What do we mean by that? What are the debates? What is happening? How is it developed? What is the sociology? Do we understand, for instance, what is caste? Do we understand that? What have we read about it? Do we understand inequity? I've been talking about it, but do we understand it as a construct? What does it mean? So I think there's a lot which is asking us to engage deeply, not just do a few lectures, but understand this and link it with field engagement. Because a lot of disjunction that is coming is also between so-called theory and so-called practice. How do we link it? How do each of our courses get linked with projects, get linked with work, get linked with coming from there and understanding? So education studies also is defining an area, a discipline of education, not saying, you know, a bit of this and a bit of that. Obviously, we are drawing upon disciplines, but we are also trying to define an education discipline. And I think that in this kind of a structure, and we have just, if I can just show you a work in progress, this is something final. Bijoy, if you could show us the other. Broadly, this kind of a structure, which has come out of many different engagements, and this is just, as I said, something that is being thought of in terms of what is this two-year B.Ed. going to be? One, why is it 2 years? 2 years, as we know, 1 year is basically less than 9 months as we run it. We resisted semesterization in our university. Ours is the only course which was not semesterized, even though there was so much pressure on us. Because we said that education is linked to many other things. We can't just split our course into two and say, okay, now it's become semester. We have to look at the school calendar, we have to look at the other calendars. So we did not make it into a semester because it becomes even more difficult and sort of meaningless. So we didn't do it. Because suddenly within internship, you know, you can't have an exam or you can't semesterize it, so we didn't. But if it's a two-year program, we can semesterize it. And it does give us time where you are on block a large part of the time when you're really, as a teacher, you are an intern in a school and teaching. But before that, you have had enough engagement. I mean, even to know children, have you had, say, a week of just observing children? Observing children at play, in the playground, observing children, working, observing children in different contexts, just trying to understand childhood. Just trying to understand different childhoods, because childhoods are social constructs. So as you learn theoretically, you also try and understand, you engage with children, and you understand what it is. So enough time to do that before you are sent into a classroom and said, come on, perform. So when you have that time and space and you engage with it, you've come back to the department, you've talked to other people, you've read readings. A lot of us learn, one, of course, through observation, but when our readings also make us critically reflect on our observation, because we can't observe unless our lenses are prepared to look for those things. And how will those lenses be prepared? And how will that thought and reflection come into it? So a two-year program which gives you that time, which gives you time to engage and also do self-development, understanding the self, because we've often found that when we critically look at our own childhoods, we question things, because very often we don't. We sort of only remember vague things about childhood, but we don't question, and we don't question it with another childhood or a different childhood, and what does it mean? And so when we understand and do a lot of self-development programs, in which there are many other things, in which theater is not just performance, theater is not doing drama. So we do drama for education, which is not acting and not role-playing and not doing that. It's a critical tool. It's a critical tool which allows a teacher to do many things in a classroom, which can even do hot seating. I mean, you can critically sort of have a character. You can have Razia Sultan critically there, and how do you engage with a historical time and even talk to Razia Sultan? So there are a lot of techniques in drama which allow us to use it as an educative tool, not for acting or not for putting up plays. So how do we do different aspects of self-development as part of the program? And then, as we said, do a lot of research-based engagement. So the engagement with the field is meant to be there for all the papers, for all the courses. And the only question that has been coming up again and again in the last few years is, and I would like you also to think about this, not just from Bombay schools, but from all schools that you might be familiar with in Maharashtra. How many pedagogy subjects does a B.Ed. have to deal with? There has been a lot of pressure, as you know, that instead of doing these two subjects, and rather than doing a whole discipline, a field for a discipline, you know that the new curriculum, even at the NCERT level, says up to class 10, we don't have subjects coming in. We have social studies, we have sciences, we have a disciplinary engagement, and then there is more specialization. But in the B.Ed., we have two subjects. So where do we bring in a disciplinary engagement? So one, the NCF says that have only one pedagogy course. But when we were deliberating across from different states, people in our committee, there is this thinking that we can have two courses, one which is a disciplinary pedagogy course, and the other one which is a subject kind of a thing. There are differences in that. But this also course is not going to be necessarily the way that we teach it now. I mean, how did... I'm sometimes surprised, even when the same, my own students from B.Ed. then come to me in M.Ed., for instance, for another engagement. I teach a course on knowledge and curriculum, or right now I'm teaching a course in science education. And I'm surprised that when they're students who've done a B.Ed., they still have never really understood what, how this discipline has shaped. They've never understood the contested ways in which even a school subject has come into the school. If you look at the last 100 years or last 200 years, how did a certain subject come into a school? What were the contestations about that subject? How was the first syllabus made? Why? And, you know, so they've never had a chance to engage with a kind of not just epistemology, but a historical background of understanding of that subject. Secondly, of understanding and engaging very clearly with how learners sort of engage with that subject. We don't have much time, the way we do it. And third, of course, myself to understand with that subject. As you all said, one of the challenges is that when students come to us, after even having done a BA program or an MA program, they may not necessarily understand the discipline or have that kind of a deeper understanding of their own discipline from which they come. So do we engage with that when we're talking of it in terms of a pedagogy course? So there are challenges at three levels, even for a pedagogy course. And the suggestion was that one pedagogy course can be done as a disciplinary course. So maybe I can take social sciences as a discipline. And in the other course, in the other semester, I can take a subject. And maybe I can take a subject which is language, or I can take another subject which I have done adequately at my undergraduate level. Because that is important. In Delhi University, we are facing a problem. With the restructuring of our BA program, in the last few years, what has happened is that someone can do one course, only one course on, say, Dalit studies, 50 marks. And then that person wants to come and do a B.Ed. and take political science as a pedagogy course. And we have often had to do that because we couldn't, we said we must have minimum 100 marks, because how can I say the person knows political science if a person has only done one 50 mark course? Similarly, Hindi, one 50 mark course, then wants to come and do the pedagogy course in Hindi. We know they're not competent in the discipline, in the subject, but this is the way the admissions are happening. There are no structures in which we can insist that they have done enough of that discipline at the undergraduate level. I don't know in the restructuring of Bombay University or other universities in Maharashtra, but they will have to go in tandem. Because if we restructure it to a point, we will have to insist that a person who's coming in for to a professional course and is doing a second subject has enough understanding, enough background of that subject. That will have to be done. Otherwise, it becomes tokenism. So this is a question that we are still deliberating of doing just one disciplinary course, again, because of the link to the school. The school wants that a teacher may have expertise of being able to teach two subjects. You know, even though the RTE is right now saying that up to the middle level, you know, teach only, there will be a special subject teacher, but there are these linkages that we have to make between the RTE, between recruitment rules, which is very difficult. We have to really push to change them, and those things take time, but we will, the NCTE will engage with all these, but also the restructuring of the BA programs in universities. So all these are the challenges before us. Not just the three documents which have shaken us up in education, but also in terms of the other movements that are happening. So just kind of having presented this overview and having presented the thrust before us, the challenges and why we really need to move in this direction, I think I will you know, ask for some kinds of responses, some your own reflections on some of these areas, because I'm sure people have been hearing these things. And also my only sort of plea is that let's not look at it only in terms of, you know, how will we do it? We cannot. We're barely doing a 9-month course. How can we do a 2-year course? All the hows will work out if first we are at least convinced of why and what is the direction and do we really need to make and strengthen the discipline of education. I think that is the challenge. Next step is, of course, how do we get students to come in for research in education? What is going to be the nature of the master's program in education? How do we get a lot of fresh air from many other disciplines coming into education? In the Delhi University, I can confidently say, for the last 12 or more years, we've run a 4-year Bachelor of Elementary Education program. And this program was not situated in a college of education. It was situated in a liberal education college. So it drew upon teachers from who were teaching different disciplines in that. It was deliberately designed as a 4-year program, not an integrated 3+1. No, it was not that. It's a holistic 4-year program. But we found that the way these students understand many of these issues and the way you see a difference, you can go into a classroom and see a difference at the elementary level of where these teachers are coming from, what their understanding is. And it's run as a bilingual program. So we provide enough support, materials, translations in Hindi also, which is normally a major issue because students fall back on terrible kunjis if we don't provide them materials in other languages. English, the teaching of English is a major issue, and I just want to flag it off. In our country, we don't have a language policy. And at every forum, wherever we've had a chance, we've been trying to say this. The 3-language formula was a formula. It was a formula which had to be devised for various reasons, as you all know, historically. What did it mean politically, socially, in terms of the role of English and the constitution and what was going to happen to Hindi? Why we don't have a national language? So all these things in the 65 and the different states which were being divided on the basis of linguistic basis, a formula had to be devised. But the northern states did not follow the formula, which clearly said that if you are a Hindi-speaking state, then your second language should preferably be a language, a southern Indian language. It said that. No state followed it. The southern states, to a large extent, except Tamil Nadu, did try and follow it. Again, this hierarchy that we were creating. So it was a contingent kind of an attempt at a certain socio-political historical moment. But in the current context, we don't have a well thought out, a well understood from the child, from the linguistic, from the perspective of language learning, we don't have a language policy. And states are just taking decisions at random, absolutely at random. Chhattisgarh decides overnight, we will do only English medium. And we have a meeting with them, but the chief minister says, no, I don't want my child to greet me in Gondi, I want my child only to say good morning. And only English will take the child where I have reached, or you know, something like that. JNK overnight, just a couple of years back, decided English medium. I know because I've been engaging with the state for the last many, many years and what it means. And suddenly it's so damaging for everyone, for the child, for the teacher and everyone. So, you know, what is the role of the first language? Even the RTE says that the mother tongue as far as possible. The words as far as possible came much later. When the draft went through many, many departments of the government, then those words were added. But this is a big issue for us. And how does a second language, English as a second language, come in? And how does it come in well? And it doesn't mean that I've learned it for 10 years and it's much better. How does it, we don't, in our schools, we don't teach as a second language. In fact, we teach language as in the worst possible manner, even the first language. That's the poorest link in our school education, anywhere, any state. Kerala is sort of the state which shows us the direction in social indicators, which has most children universalized. But till they actually changed their curriculum some years back, children studying in class 4 could speak and think so beautifully, but they couldn't write in Malayalam. So we teach language in the most sort of outdated manner. But what language policy? How do children learn language? How should we be teaching languages and not forcing children to learn English right from day one, wherever the child comes from? So all these understandings, that is something that we need to engage with, and also our own teachers. So there's a special course which is recognized as language and communication and meaning making for all our teachers. Because we understand that even if you have to read a passage and make sense of that passage and critically read a passage, not necessarily, our undergraduates are not trained to do that. So even we expect them to read a lot of literature, but what do they read? How do they write themselves? Our system has more and more sort of disenabled our students to write themselves, think and write themselves. A lot of cut-paste happens because of computers now. So where does, how is that important for education? And language is not just communication, language is thought. Thinking, that gets hampered if we don't really look at the world through our language. We look at the world, we establish relationships through our language. So what does that mean? So that is also a course. So I'm saying that this is broadly the kind of overview that comes through all these documents that are before us. And I would like some reflections, however brief, but some kinds of reflections, some challenges, and how we think we can move ahead.